Hey everyone! Today we're exploring how to extend JavaScript's abilities on the Flipper Zero. We'll start by learning how to use JavaScript FFI code to make the Flipper Zero play tones. Next, we'll dive into how C code can give JavaScript access to the video game module's sensor data. We'll combine our new abilities in a JavaScript that plays different tones as you rotate the Flipper Zero. You can use these same techniques to read temperature sensors or do more complex things like send infrared signals. Let's get started. We're extending JavaScript, so I'm in official firmware, but these steps should work on all the available firmware. I've opened Applications, System, JS App, and I've created two files under example scripts. The first is ademo.js. This file uses the speaker and VGM modules that we'll be creating in this video. The speaker module is written entirely in JavaScript and is named speakerapi.js. Our goal is to allow JavaScript developers to access the speaker using a play command. The command will take the frequency, the volume, and the duration of the note. The technique for our first module is FFI, foreign function interface, so we use the load command to populate the speaker object. Official firmware does not automatically populate the __dir path global, so we set it explicitly to our scripts directory. I've opened fruihowspeaker.h on the right, which is the Flipper API for accessing the speaker. To play a tone, we would acquire the speaker, check that it was acquired, start the speaker with the frequency and volume, delay for the length of the tone, stop the speaker, and then release the speaker. Next, we use FFI to import the four methods. FFI signatures use primitives, void, int, float, double, void, asterisk for objects, char star for null terminated strings, and user data for callbacks. So to convert fruihow speaker acquire, we would change that bool into an int, and then our uint32 into an int. The frui warn unused is just a hint that we should be using the function's return value. Release, start, and stop all use primitives, so we just copy those signatures over. I'm using underscores for internal variables and functions. Let me know in the comments if there's a JavaScript way of specifying internals. Our JavaScript acquire function checks our local acquired variable. If it's false, meaning we haven't already acquired the speaker, we call the FFI underscore acquire function, passing the timeout. We store and return the result. Our acquired function just returns the local underscore acquired variable. Our release function will call our FFI underscore release function, and we set the local underscore acquired variable to false. Finally, our play function checks if we've already acquired the speaker. If not, we try to acquire the speaker. If we've acquired the speaker, we call our FFI start function. We delay for the duration, and then we call our FFI stop function. If the play function tried to acquire the speaker, we also call the release function. The advantage to FFI is you can ship a script file and the firmware doesn't need to be updated. The disadvantage is you only have access to exported APIs, and you need to be careful if you use any enumeration values, as those values can change when the features are updated or when it's run on a different firmware. Next, we'll look at creating a C module that accesses the video game module. Writing a C module is helpful when you need to access APIs that aren't part of the firmware, or if you want to ensure your enumeration values are correct. On the left, I have our test JavaScript. In the middle window, I've opened jsvgm.c, which is a file we created, and it's in a jsvgm folder under the modules folder. I've also copied the IMU and ICM files that are part of the video game engine and not part of the firmware, and I put all of these in that JSVGM folder as well. On the right, I've opened the imu.h header file so you can see what APIs the video game engine sensor exposes. In the bottom right, I've opened application.fam file, and we've added an entry for JS VGM EP as our entry point. And we've also specified where our .c files live. In our JavaScript code, we use the require command to load a C module. You can see our VGM module has four functions: get pitch, get roll, get yaw, and delta yaw. At the top of our jsvgm.c file, we have our typical include statements. I've also added an include to imu.h, which are those sensor methods on the right. We define a tag so we can do logging. We also define jsvgminst, which holds our properties for the module. Jumping down to the bottom of the file, we see our entry point, jsvgmep, and it returns a plugin descriptor. Above that, we define our plugin descriptor having an entry point property of jsvgmdesk. Above that, we define jsvgmdesk as having a module name VGM, which is what we use in a require statement. And we also define two methods, the create and the destroy. In our create function, we allocate memory for our instance, and then we call imu-alloc to initialize the video game module and store the imu property. We then call imu-present to determine if the imu was connected and store it in the present property. If the imu was not present, we log a warning. Next, we make a JavaScript object and set the various properties on it, pointing to our functions. We then set an object to our object parameter, and we return the instance we created. Our destroy code just frees the objects. We'll jump up to the top of the file, and we'll look at that jsvgmgetPitch function. These first three lines give us our instance, and you pretty much do this pattern in all of your methods that you expose to JavaScript. If present is set, we'll call imu-pitch-get to get the pitch, and then we'll make that into a JavaScript number, and then we'll return it to our JavaScript function. If the VGM was not present, we log a trace message, and then we return undefined to our JavaScript. You'll see that our getRoll and our getYaw functions are very similar. Our jsvgmDeltaYaw function is a more complex example. Over in our JavaScript, you'll see that DeltaYaw takes two parameters, the angle that it's waiting for, and the timeout. Those first three lines give us back our instance. Next, we get the number of arguments that were in the JavaScript call, and if it's not enough or too many, we set an error message, we return undefined, and then we use the return statement to exit the function. If the VGM was not present, we log a trace message and we return undefined to JavaScript. Don't forget to use that return keyword to exit our void function. MSJ return doesn't exit the function, it just sets the JavaScript result. Next, we get the first parameter, which starts at 0. We convert it to a double, and if it's not a number, NaN, we set an error message, we return undefined, and then exit the function. If the number of arguments is 2, we get that second argument, and we convert it to an int. Otherwise, we set the milliseconds to a default value of 3000. We set our timeout to the current time plus the number of milliseconds in the future. We set the initial yaw to whatever the current reading is. And then we set the current yaw. We call a method to compute the distance in degrees between the current and initial yaw and return the distance if it exceeds that angle. If the distance is non-zero, then that means we've exceeded the angle, and we create a number with a diff and return it. Otherwise, we delay 100 milliseconds, and if we haven't exceeded our timeout, we loop back to that do statement. If we've exited the while loop because we've exceeded our timeout, then we return a value of 0. Next, we'll open js_app.c, and then we'll choose terminal, run task, and then we'll choose flash USB with resources. make sure that Qflipper is not running and that you don't have any open browsers running. In the past, Control-Shift-B key bindings brought up that build menu, but now it seems like it binds to a default action. Let me know in the comments if you know how to fix that. In our application.fam, our app ID is js_app, and our app type is system in official firmware. So this means we need to rebuild the system and deploy new firmware when we make changes to the modules or any of the C code. If your changes are just to a JS file, you can copy them over onto your Flipper. Other firmwares, instead of system, treat this as an external app, which means you can pull up that build menu and then choose launch app on Flipper, and it will update just that one application. So after that builds and deploys, you should get a firmware update success message. Go ahead and click OK. And then if we go into apps and we go into scripts, we should see our JS file, a demo.js. There's that beep and our VGM data. And when I rotate it, you can see I've rotated it 50 degrees. So now we're ready to make a JavaScript application that uses both of these modules to make different tones when the Flipper zero is rotated. At the top of the file, we use require and load to import our new features. We then set some default values for the app, like the delta angle, the wait time, and the frequency. For the first 5 seconds, we just display the pitch, roll, and yaw data, so you can kind of rotate the Flipper around and see that data. And then we loop 500 times. We print the current frequency. We play a tone at 100% volume for 250 milliseconds. And then we use that delta yaw to figure out if the Flipper is being rotated. If the delta returns undefined, then there was no VGM detected, so there's no reason to loop 500 times, so we just exit our loop. Otherwise, we do some math to that delta to try to bring it into a value around 1.1 or negative 1.1, or it'll be zero if it didn't exceed the angle threshold. So if our delta is greater than zero, we multiply the frequency by the delta, so that increases the frequency about 10%. And if the delta is less than zero, we divide the frequency by the negative delta, which reduces it about 10%. And then our loop repeats and we'll play the new tone. Right click on the JavaScript file, reveal in File Explorer, bring up Qflipper, and then over in Qflipper, go to Files, SD Card, Apps, and then Scripts. And then go ahead and drag your JS file into your Flipper. And now when you go into the Flipper, you should be able to say apps and then go to the scripts directory. And inside of your scripts folder, you should now see the new JS file. Now you know two techniques for extending the features in JavaScript. Please like and subscribe. Also, let me know in the comments or on my Discord server which features you want added to JavaScript.